Welcome to Getting Sketchy Live, brought to you by thevirtualinstructor.com. And now, let's get sketchy.
Hello there, everyone. Matt here with thevirtualinstructor.com, and welcome to Getting Sketchy Live, which we all know is the greatest live broadcast here on YouTube. Getting Sketchy Live is where either myself or my good friend and fellow artist and art teacher, Ashley Hirsch, tries to create a drawing for you inside of 45 minutes. And of course, we're sprinkling in some art instruction as well. So tonight we're going to be working with Halloween Candy Classic, which we'll reveal in just a minute. We're going to be working with pastels as well, and I'm going to be working on pastel matte paper. We'll talk more about that in a minute, but first we need to say hello to Ashley, who's sitting right over there. How you doing?
I'm doing great, Matt. Thanks for asking. I hope you guys are all doing well out there. You guys are joining us from all over, South Dakota, Ohio, Minnesota, so keep coming in. We're going to do some drawing in just a minute.
Yeah, we're getting ready to go here in just a minute. So if you don't have pastels, you want to work with a different medium, that's fine. We're going to be doing a pretty simple drawing. It's really based on color and value. But you can definitely do this with a pencil or with a pen, with pen and ink even, or colored pencils. Of course, I'm going to be trying to create this drawing inside of 45 minutes, so that makes the challenge a little bit harder. But of course, this is called Getting Sketchy. So we're going to be loose. We're going to be quick. We're not going to create a full finished drawing, but if that's the kind of stuff that you're interested in, I'd like to remind you about our membership program over at thevirtualinstructor.com. We offer a variety of drawing and painting courses. All of them are included in the membership program. And after tonight's broadcast, we're going to be over there at thevirtualinstructor.com, continuing with our live lesson series. In fact, we're finishing up a live lesson series tonight, where I am drawing a portrait of my youngest daughter. So the live lessons are also included with the membership program. There's also weekly critiques, which are part of the Members Minute, and a year-long curriculum for visual arts teachers that includes everything you would need to teach, minus the materials, of course. All of that is included in the membership program. If you want to check out our membership program, there is a link below this video. You can check it out, of course. Everyone starts with a free trial for a week. If you want to check out three of our course videos and ebooks for free, you can do that as well. There's a link below this video as well. Clicking on it will, of course, give you access, or you click on it, put your email address, then it will give you access to three of our course videos and ebooks for free. You can check those out. It'll also put you on our mailing list so that you get updated when we post new videos. And of course, when we go live here on Getting Sketchy, you'll be notified of that as well. Is there anything else I need to say?
I would just mention that if you have a comment that you would like read, just be sure to put it in capital letters. Sometimes the chat box gets rolling pretty fast, and the capital letters will help me see it. I won't think that you're screaming at me, I promise.
Yeah, again, the chat box here on YouTube does get rolling pretty fast. So if you do have a comment or question, it doesn't have to be about what we're talking about tonight or doing tonight. It could be anything art related. And either myself or Ashley would do our best to answer those questions for you. So welcome to everybody from around the world, Australia, Texas, Oregon, Washington, the Jersey Shore, New Jersey, Northern Ireland, Southern Arizona. We're so glad that you guys are here with us tonight. And I'm ready to dive into this one. I'm a little nervous about this one because I am working with pastels, but I'm nervous anytime I do a live drawing. And I've been doing live drawings either broadcast here on YouTube or on thevirtualinstructor.com since 2012. And I still get nervous. So I guess that's pretty normal. So let's go ahead and switch over and get into this one. All right, so over here on the right, you see my drawing surface, and I have actually taped off an area that is 5 by 7. So this is 5 inches, this is 7 inches, and this is on pastel matte paper. Now, pastel matte paper is a little bit pricey, but this paper features a very, very fine tooth. The tooth is the texture of the paper, and this texture may not look like there's much there. Even when I rub my finger over it, it doesn't even sound like there's much. Mm-hmm. But when you start making marks with the pastels, you'll notice that the pastel material is much less dusty and it really stays in its place. We're still going to be able to blend a little bit with our fingers, which is something I like to do with pastels. But this paper really holds the material in place. Again, it is very pricey, and If you order it online, sometimes you have to wait for it to come. It's not necessarily on prom.
Now, how big are the sheets that you order?
The sheets I have are pretty large. I think this might be 12 by 17. So
okay.
I'm just eyeballing that here. I don't have the pad out
so
in front of me.
So you would get like four small drawings out of a sheet like that?
Yeah, but typically when I work on this paper, I'd work a little bit larger.
Okay.
But you know, you don't have to, but I am using this for getting sketchy tonight. I am creating a sketch on some pretty expensive paper. So if you want to substitute this paper with less expensive paper, there's Canson-Mitant's paper, which is fantastic. That paper is not cheap, but it's not expensive like this PastelMat paper is. Or you can just work on any toned or colored paper. I'm working on a very light gray surface. It may look white, but it's actually a very light gray surface. Now, I have an assortment of materials that I'm going to be using here. So I'm just going to pull one of each one of these out. This is just a regular soft pastel. I'll refer to this as a stick pastel, even though it's clearly not a stick, but that's to differentiate it against pastel pencils. So I have a few pastel pencils out in front of me too. And I also have these things right here, a few of these. These are new pastels, and new pastels are now made by Prismacolor, I believe, but they used to be made by New Pastel. I mean, this is really old. This is so old that it's got a Kmart sticker on it, and it's in the home improvement section. And this whole pack of New Pastels, $3.24.
Wow, that is old.
$3.
Look at the package design, too.
Yeah.
It's great. It's got a painter's palette on it. I love that.
And it's made to look like this center part sticks out. Do you see that?
Mm-hmm.
See how the...
Yeah. Yep.
They've
it's supposed to look dimensional.
The value that makes it look like the light source is coming from
it's
below.
A little
that's
bit of
cool.
illusion there.
Yeah,
that's
see,
nice.
It's flat. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And this is just a cover over the top here. So,
hey, so could you say the brand of the pastel matte paper that you're using one more time?
It's by Clairefontaine.
Okay.
Clairefontaine makes pastel matte paper. And the pastel matte paper is, I think it's like an official name. Like it's not a type of paper like Bristol paper.
Okay.
It is a, it is like the name brand.
We do have a couple of questions
of
around that. Speaking of Bristol, would Bristol board vellum work pretty well for this as well? The vellum surface?
Bristol board is, even Bristol paper with a vellum surface is still very smooth. You can use any surface that you want, but since we're using pastels, you do want to have a little bit of tooth there so you can get layers down.
So regular drawing paper may be better than Bristol board vellum for
this. Yes, regular drawing paper definitely better than Bristol board vellum. And Bristol smooth surface, forget about it.
Let's see, 3698 also asks, how does this paper compare to Canson-Mitant's touch pastel paper?
Okay, I'm not sure about the touch pastel paper, but the Canson-Mitant's regular pastel paper has two distinct sides. One side has a little bit of tooth. The other side has a heavy tooth. And this paper, when you feel it, this paper, it doesn't feel like there's much there at all. But when you start making marks, you realize it's kind of like a fine sandpaper.
It's like a microscopic tooth almost. It's you just can't. You'd have to get really close to see the pits in the paper.
It's really like a fine grit sandpaper.
Mm-hmm.
And the Mitant's paper isn't like that at all. It's just kind of more like textured paper.
Yes, you can clearly see the texture
even
on the finer side of the Mitant's.
Absolutely. And the brand of pastels I'm using are Rembrandt pastels, which are my favorite soft pastels. They're my favorite just because I've invested so much money in them. But anyway, you got a little bit of pastel dust right there. We'll be able to cover that up. So I'm going to go ahead and start the timer, I think. Are we ready?
Let's go ahead and start the timer. No more questions about the paper.
I'm going to be sketching my drawing out here or sketching the basic shapes using a white pastel pencil, which might be a little bit hard to see on the screen, but I don't want my marks to be too dark and stand out too much. Hopefully that makes sense as to why I'm doing that.
Okay, right. I'll let you know how it's looking to us over here on the screens.
All right, I'm going to start the timer, 45 minutes, and go.
Go.
All right, so I'm going to start down here at the bottom of the picture plane, and I'm going to just try to get that first candy corn in place. And
the top of that candy corn is almost level, but just not quite. Looks like it goes uphill like 2 degrees.
Slightly uphill. And you know what, guys? If we don't get the everything in its place perfectly, it's no big deal.
Sure.
I think a lot of people get all wrapped up in that. And sometimes it is a big deal. But in this particular case, it's not that big of a deal.
June asks, I only have pastel pencils. Is that okay?
Oh, absolutely. It is. Yeah, totally. You can definitely get away with just using pastel pencils for this. Any medium that you have laying around, you're still going to be working those observational muscles.
That's right. Even if you were just to do a grayscale drawing in pencil.
Yeah. So any medium that you have, as long as you're working those observational muscles.
I like that, observational muscles.
Yeah. All right, so we're going to move up a little bit higher on the picture plane. This is somewhere near the middle of the picture plane.
Before you started drawing and talking about pastels, there was some conversation in the chat about what in the world is candy corn? Not everybody has eaten candy corn. And it's here in the United States. We've been eating it for generations, and we're still not exactly sure what candy corn is.
I'm not really sure.
So we know it's pretty much sugar, and I would assume it's just 100% corn syrup. That would be my guess. I've never looked it up. Maybe somebody wants to. I don't know if it's worth it, but it is. What we do as children here is try to put them on our teeth to make fangs around Halloween. So you can see they're fang-like. Somebody mentioned they're sort of the shapes of earbuds. I'm telling you, if you made some earbuds that look like candy corn, you could take that to the bank. That would be very popular.
That's a good idea.
That's a great idea. So let's get on that.
Candy corn. Well, obviously, it's supposed to look like corn, kind of.
The yellow part looks like it would be corn on a cob that's been pulled out and has the root of a molar behind it. Something you didn't expect to come out of that corn, or that corn cob.
Okay, so got our basic shape sketched out here really quickly. I'm going to go ahead and put it a little bit of indication of where we're going to have a shadow. Might be strange drawing this with a white pastel pencil, but we'll be able to go over the top of it. And there's actually two light sources. I know this because I set up two light sources for this drawing. But I'm actually going to only pull out one. So that's going to be the one that has the dominant shadow, or opposite of the dominant shadow. You can see the light source coming from the left is a little bit stronger. So we're going to let that shadow be the one that we use here in this drawing.
Some people are telling us in the chat that I've seen a couple of comments that mention they can be made or could be made with honey and color. I would like that better than the corn syrup. And, you know, now that you mention it, I think I've had candy corn that was made with corn syrup and without, and the kind without corn syrup, the colors were more natural. I guess maybe the dyes were natural. So there's a few versions of candy corn out there. But what Matt's drawing tonight is the real stuff, I believe.
Well, and I don't eat candy corn, really. I don't know. I think maybe I had an experience where I ate too much of it or something. I don't know. You don't have to eat much of it before you start feeling sick.
Right. You don't have to eat much before you've scarred yourself and never want to eat it again. At least not until next year.
And candy corn only comes out at Halloween around here, too. Yeah. So at least around here, it only comes out at Halloween, but... So Halloween is Sunday, of course, and we get pumped up for Halloween around here. Well, at least my wife really does. She decorates everything. We've got a giant spider web in the foyer that is so big.
The entire ceiling is a cobweb.
Yes, and there's big spiders on it. Anyway, I just go with it. So this composition here is seemingly fairly sparse. There's a lot of negative space in this scene. And this is an example of a composition where we have mostly negative space and little positive space. And a lot of times people ask me, how much positive and negative space do I need to have? And I always tell them, well, you need to have a balance. and that's different for every subject and every composition.
So. And also what you want to say with your art. Remember, art is about communicating sometimes, and you may want a lot of negative space sometimes to make your subject feel lonely or isolated. It could be the message of your artwork. So there's reasons to have very crowded compositions and almost empty compositions. Balance is a good rule of thumb.
Yeah, that's a good point you made there, trying to convey an emotion through the art idea. And the way the composition is laid out. But some compositions work well with very little negative space, and some work well with lots of negative space, and some work well with an equal amount of positive and negative space, and we could have cropped this composition differently to create an image that's mostly positive space.
Or yeah, you could have let the top and bottom candy corn go off the top and bottom of the page, and it would have still been successful, I think, and had a lot less white space.
Yeah, if we zoomed in real close, that's another example. All right, now I'm going to go ahead and start finding the colors that I'm going to use here, and we'll start with the oranges. So I'm going to start with just a base orange here, and this guy looks pretty good. I picked out a few colors. Let's see, I think this is the other half here. So I picked out a few colors. There's definitely some darker reds that are happening in there as well. So we're just going to get the basic shapes filled in with a solid color first, and then we're going to adjust the values. So this is going to be our base color for the orange. And you can see, if you've used pastels before, there's something odd happening here.
it's dense.
Where is the dust going?
Right, it's saying right where it's supposed to be so far.
And that's the beauty of the pastel matte paper. So you can still blend this here, but you don't have to worry about dust flying everywhere. And that is also a little bit reflective of the brand of pastel that you use, too. Mm-hmm. The cheaper brands typically have more dust and kind of fly around on you, which is fine. There's some great inexpensive pastel brands out there that are pretty dusty. Now, I'm not worried too much about my edges because I'm going to go back and finish those with an application of kind of a light blue in the background. We're going to have a light blue background. At least that's my plan.
Okay, when we get there, we'll talk a little more about color because that's a major player in your composition. There are a couple of comments, one about candy corn and one about pastel pencils. First, Brent Does Art tells us that candy corn and peanuts go well together. Doesn't know why? It's a mystery. Brent Does Art, I'm going to try that because I love peanuts and peanut butter. So anything that's going to enhance my peanut eating experience, I'm going to give that a shot. Thanks for the advice. And let's see, June asks, is there a trick to sharpening pastel pencils? Never used before. Well, you know, they can break easily. I'll tell you the best, I won't say the best, something that I like to do with pencils, materials that have a soft filament, like colored pencils and pastel pencils, is to actually use a pretty sharp, fast-moving electric pencil sharpener. And I know there are people that do not use colored pencils or anything other than graphite in electric pencil sharpeners because they feel like it wears them out and breaks them a little bit faster. And maybe it does, but that's okay. It's a machine. It wears out and you can get another one. I've had dozens of electric pencil sharpeners. And the second trick that goes along with that is not to push them too hard into the electric pencil sharpener. Really feel like the sharpener is just shaving the pastel pencils and colored pencils. So that's me. And then also, you can sharpen them with a razor blade. You know, you can have a really sharp razor blade or a new X-Acto knife. But the real key is very sharp blades, whether you're using, you know, a handheld pencil sharpener or an electric pencil sharpener, so that it doesn't break that soft filament.
And it depends on the pencil for me. Like these... Mm-hmm. Let's see, Carbothello pencils. I always want to call them Stabilo, which I think is the company that makes them. But the Carbothello pastel pencils are the size of a regular pencil. So you can use them in a regular pencil sharpener. Mm-hmm. I use a handheld pencil sharpener for everything. I don't even have an electric pencil sharpener in the studio here. But for the larger pastel pencils?
The ones I used last week?
Yeah, like the Conte Apparis.
Yeah, they wouldn't fit.
Pastels, no. You really need to use a knife for those.
Yeah.
All right, I've got my base orange in place, so we'll come back to that in just a minute.
I love that little orange spot that bleeds up into the yellow, just like for variety. Too. Just a little variety in there.
All right, we're ready for our base yellow.
Now, something Matt's done in this composition, you know, he's got a group of three, and that's always a good idea. Odd-numbered still lives just seem to not feel static and boring. Sometimes it's hard to arrange a grouping of four without accidentally kind of creating this feeling of a square effect.
It's about competition.
Yeah.
They're all fighting for, when you have an even number.
Yeah, that's right.
It's kind of hard to figure out what to focus on.
Well, that's what I was getting to, is Matt has very successfully used the principle of art emphasis here. So, you know, there's elements of art and principles of art. And the principles are a little bit more vague. It's things like balance and emphasis, where there's a lot of right answers, not just one, like when we're talking about, you know, what is a line or what is a shape, you know, those being the elements of art. So two ways that you can, and there's several ways to emphasize an area in your artwork or a thing. These are all the same thing. So, you know, you can't, one candy corn isn't going to stand out because it's different than the other. But one is larger than the other in the composition. So I think that's the best way. To describe the piece in the foreground as being emphasized. But another great way that is evident in this composition is through isolation. So we've got a grouping, and then we've got this one thing that stands off by itself. And it's going to stand out because of that. Even if it wasn't larger, or even if it was something different or even less colorful, if that candy corn in the foreground, just through its isolation, that tells us that it's sort of being emphasized. It's a little bit of the main character. So nice job using scale and isolation to create emphasis in this composition.
Well, I'm used to isolation.
You're emphasized all the time, aren't you?
I'm used to isolation. And when I was a kid, I'd get in trouble. Always get isolated.
You got put, you had to go to the room under the stairs.
You know, this is going to sound terrible, but it's true. I still have a memory when I was in preschool of running around crazy in the preschool, of course. But I was put in the mat closet.
The closet?
The closet, where they held the mats. And I think that was pretty standard, because I remember other kids going in there, and I remember the day I got put in the mat closet thinking, well, finally happened to me. It's my turn. Just here in the mat closet.
So only one person would be sent to the closet. It was the isolation was the punishment, right?
I guess so, yeah.
Yeah. Now, I had to stand in the corner in the third grade. I hated that. I could feel everybody's eyes looking at me.
But yeah, that's isolation.
Of course, I couldn't see them.
Isolation
brighter
used
note,
to be
the,
a,
what's that?
Isolation used to be a viable method for punishment.
Yeah. Well, it still is, right? Solitary confinement, it's still used.
Yeah, but if I was in prison, I think I'd want to be in solitary confinement.
You know? I don't know. Maybe depends on how long.
From what I've heard about
depends
prison.
Depends on the prison know? And how long the confinement is, I guess. I don't want to find out.
I don't want to find out. All right. Now, what's tricky here is the tips of these candy corn are not white. They're kind of a grayish off-white.
I noticed that.
So I need to kind of come up with a mixture because I've got these two colors here, but neither one of them are really the right color. It feels like there needs to be a little bit of a gray in there. So I'm going to find a gray here. I'm going to put the gray down.
Okay, just
first.
Real quick for Sherry, who missed the beginning of the show, these are not oil pastels. These are regular dry pastels or soft pastels. And then also Matt's going to be using some pastel pencils as well. And Jen points out the reason maybe you were put in that closet is because it is called the matte closet.
Yep. That's not the reason why. But, yeah. All right. So I'm going to put down the gray first. And then over the gray, we're going to bring in a little bit of this kind of off-white color. And
okay,
that'll work. It's not exactly the same color, but it keeps it
pretty toned down.
It's still the same unnatural-looking color that the candy corn is. Yeah.
Sherry now asks, what's the difference between soft pastels and oils? I guess that's oil pastels. Mm-hmm. And therein lies the answer. It's the binder. So oil pastels are held together with some kind of a non-drying oil, some kind of like a vegetable oil of some sort, maybe different from brand to brand. And then the regular or soft pastels, the binder is gum arabic, which is completely dry. It's the same binder that's in watercolor paint, which dries very fast. And so you're really kind of working with a dry media versus a wet media. But they both blend and blend together really well, not with one another, but each respectively with its own type. And so you can create nice and smooth gradations and sort of soft, soft edges pretty easily with either of those media.
Yeah, they're dramatically different not dramatically different, but they're considerably different in how you use them. Like right now I'm going over the top of this gray application with kind of a lighter touch with this off-white color. Mm-hmm. With oil pastels, even if I was putting heavy pressure, it would be mixing like crazy, and it is mixing.
Yeah.
But if I want to, with a soft pastel, I can cover this up completely. So you
Without
can see I put heavier pressure,
mm-hmm.
and it covers up the gray underneath. So this gives me a little bit of freedom to, you know, go over the top of areas, and I don't have to really think too much. I have to think about it a little bit, but I don't have to, like, overthink my layering process. Because I can always go back, as long as I don't fill up the tooth of the paper. But with oil pastels, you really need to think about the layering process when mm-hmm. you're applying the colors because of that mixing that occurs. Oil pastels are very similar to colored pencils, believe it or not, in the way they should be used or thought about anyway.
The way they layer and mix, the way they mix together. Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'm going to do a little bit of blending here with my finger.
Okay. And while you do, Tiffany asks, do they feel like chalk or crayons? And they feel more like chalk.
Yeah, they feel more like chalk than crayons, but...
Tiffany also mentions that the tip of the candy corn kind of look like teeth, the color of teeth.
Yeah,
I thought the same thing, but I didn't want to say so.
All right, let's start pushing some of the values. We'll start down here on this candy corn in the foreground, and I'm going to start making some of the yellows have a little bit more variety. We'll start with the yellow ochre here, just creating some shadow. And this might not be dark enough. We might have to go darker still, but at least we'll gradually build it up here. I'm using a new pastel for this.
Now, what was that color? What's that color?
Pastel. Yellow ochre.
Okay.
Well, it is.
It's a dull yellow.
It doesn't have a name on it.
It's a dull yellow, probably yellow ochre.
Dull
it's
yellow.
Gotta be.
Probably yellow ochre. There is a listing on the inside of that package of the colors, though. So
okay.
Probably yellow ochre's in there. So I'm just looking at the shapes of darker value. I'm not trying to cover up the base yellow completely, but as you can see, quite a bit of it did get filled up there a little bit.
That highlight's starting to show up now. Rakshi Bala asks, what are your opinions on plein air painting and drawing? Any tips? It's funny you asked that. I was talking about plein air painting just today with a few of my students. And I've done some of that. Matt's done some of that. I think I wrote an article about plein air painting for the virtual instructor maybe about a year and a half or so ago. I do work outside, but I got to be honest, I'm kind of a studio artist. I like to be pretty comfortable, and I love the idea, the romance of carrying all my materials out, you know, hiking up a beautiful trail and finding just the right spot and capturing a fleeting moment. I love the notion of that, like the French Impressionists did. But when I am outside working, I get irritated easily. My paper's blowing around. If there's any wind at all, I start to get irritated. And then, you know, if it's sunny, I'm not moving around. So one side of my face just keeps getting hotter and hotter. Can't turn around, right, because I'm facing my subject. So I guess I'm a little bit, I feel a little bit like I'm glass half empty talking about plein air painting, because there are, you know, it is great to be able to do that, to get out into the world and kind of try to capture those momentary experiences. But I just get a little bit frustrated with the wind and the heat or the cold. So and ordinarily, I'm an outdoorsy person. I really prefer to be outside, but not for art making. So I'm kind of a studio artist, I guess. So my advice then would be to keep in mind that you are going to be out in the elements. You know, so don't just be thinking about your art supplies and your subject. Make sure you're comfortable. You know, if your brain is not in a good place, then you won't feel creative. So make sure you take sunscreen and plenty of water and, you know, maybe even an umbrella to work under. Just don't forget those things, because those are the kind of things that I never thought about when I was younger and would work outside and probably didn't stay out as long as I should have.
Okay, I'm darkening the value slightly and also lessening the intensity of the color here with the gray. And this is obviously a pastel pencil, and I'm putting mm-hmm. a light touch on this, and then I'm going to go back over the top of it with another yellow again. So there should be some mixing that happens here.
While you're working with the pencils, I have a color pencil question from Buddy for you. Matt, do Rembrandt pastels have a similar softness to the Carbothello pencils?
No, the Carbothello pencils are harder. They're really better suited for details. You can see even with these marks I'm making how it's moving the pastel around. You see that? Mm-hmm. Could you tell when I blew it away?
Yeah.
Means that these pencils are harder than the Rembrandt pastels. All right. Is this the base yellow? I don't know. I think it might be.
Let's see. We got another comment. Remember, there are a lot of comments in caps right now that I'm going to start trying to catch up to, and there's some comments that are not in caps, and I'll try to read those too if it looks like they're directed to us, but capital letters help. Eli Abramovich asks, when I drew with pastels as a kid, my hands would become so messy. That's true. Some people will put paper towels around one half of their stick pastels just so that their hands aren't actually touching it. And of course, I like to work with my pastel paper tipped up vertically so that if there is pastel dust, it's dropping off while I work and I don't have to blow on it and just kind of stir it up into the air. So you can work vertically. That'll help keep your workspace a little bit cleaner, not necessarily your hands. They are a little dirty.
Again, I'm not worried about this going outside of the boundaries of the candy corn too much, since we're going to be cleaning that up. And I'm going to grab this really light yellow here.
Brent Does Art asks, Matt, what is your opinion on Derwent pastel pencils? I really like them.
I don't think I've ever used Derwent pastel pencils, actually, but I can tell you that I really like all of Derwent's products. So I'm willing to bet they're probably pretty good.
Donna mentioned something else that can be challenging with a plein air artwork, depending on your medium. And I'm thinking as a painter, because I usually paint, and it's glare. Yeah, that's right. You know, sometimes as the sun moves, you got to tilt or change the tilt of your canvas. I really feel like I'm complaining now, just to keep that glare down. So that's another one. It can glare in your eyes, from the environment, your tools, but to also from your artwork itself. Joan asks, are you doing any finger blending? Yes, Matt does get his fingers into his pastel. Some media it's okay to use our fingers. And this is sort of one of them. I think oil pastels are too. So speaking of your fingers getting dirty from the pastel, some of us, it's part of our process. We use our fingers as tools sometimes. I never use my fingers with a graphite drawing. I feel like that's a real no-no. But with pastels and oil pastels and even oil paint, I'll still use my fingers sometimes.
I'm the same way, but I don't really use my finger for the oil pastels. It seems like it's just too much work.
With almost anything, honestly, with oil pastels.
I use a colorless blender for oil pastels, just like with colored
pastels. Okay, yeah, that's right. I forgot that they even made colored blenders for oil pastels. Oh, and Sketch Shinover did mention that they are disappointed that William Shatner came all the way back to Earth and nobody had Planet of the Apes masks on. So
yeah, sorry. Yeah. We'll try to get that together.
We really missed an opportunity there.
All right. Let's see. It's probably too early.
Okay, so for clarity, and this is a pastel question, Buddy is asking, are pan pastels the softest, and then maybe Rembrandt or comparable brands, and then things like the Carbothellos? Does that sound accurate to you? You know, I don't really use pan pastels much, so I don't know how they feel.
I don't know if the pan pastels are just the powder.
Yeah, they're just like their own animal. Do they have a binder? Do they have gum arabic mixed into them like the sticks do?
Maybe just a little bit of binder. Okay. I'm imagining. I'm not really sure.
Okay. Very powdery then.
Yeah. I'm going to bring back a little bit more of that base yellow that we were using before. really feel like I'd like to intensify yellows. Kind of feel like I don't want the values to be quite as dark as they are in the reference either.
Okay.
Let's go ahead and start working on the reds that we're going to add here. So I'm going to grab a red here. And just trying to look at the subtle changes in value that happen there. Really subtle. I'm using this red to make some of the values darker, obviously.
There's a question about Copic markers and why don't we use Copic markers. Matt actually did a drawing, was that 2 weeks ago, where you started with a marker base and did some blending, but you were using what kind of markers?
I was using Prismacolor Premier. Okay.
They were still alcohol-based, and they still blend.
Yeah, they're...
So they're comparable to Copic markers.
They're comparable to the Copics, yeah.
It's a different brand, but same, you know, similar. It could have been used. The Copics could have been used in the same process.
Quick little blend here. Again, it may look a little bit messy, but around the edges, but that will be cleaned up.
Yeah. So. You got some shadows to work on down there. That'll be your chance.
Let's see if we can get some grays going on in here.
All right. Let's see. We've got a pan pastel question for you from Tracy. What is the best use of pan pastels other than for backgrounds? Do you use your pan pastels throughout your artwork sometimes, or pretty much keep them in the background?
I have done, I think, exactly one piece where I used just pan pastels.
For the whole thing?
Right. Okay. And I know that pan pastels are kind of a little bit of a rage. People really like them. And I think, personally, I think they're best suited for, like, underpaintings. In which you go over the top with pastel applications. But what was the question? Something about landscapes?
Is there a good application to use pan pastels for besides backgrounds?
Oh, backgrounds.
So that may be a landscape, or it could be an interior space, but sort of broad areas, I guess, is what I take from that.
Yeah, I think that some people use them in a way where they resemble, a pastel painting from start to finish.
You can tip the applicator up on its edge to make thinner marks, I guess, with it.
Yeah.
Get a little variety from the applicator, just like you would a normal brush. Maybe I would say paintings of soft subjects, maybe birds, that kind of a thing, flowers. I would go for it.
Okay, this is a darker, warmer gray. Just, again, pushing some of the shadowed areas here. That helps our yellows make a little bit more sense.
Incidentally, Brent Does Art says that he does landscapes in pan pastels, and I'm going to take that as all pan pastels, uses them for the whole thing. So that would be foreground and background, but it's still sticking with an organic subject matter. I think it would lend itself to that. Here's a question from Grad Lib. Do oil pastels get old? I have some from the 60s. I would guess they probably do. Now, I know they're supposed to be a non-drying oil, but I've never used any oil pastels that old. So I think you're just going to have to take one of those out of the pack and maybe go get a new pack and just test them out. And then let us know if there's any difference.
There's only one way to find out.
Yep, one way to find out to an answer to a question like that. You got to give it a shot. Make a comparison.
I want to make the top of this candy corn a little bit lighter, but I need to find a light orange to do so. I don't know if you heard that or not, but that was all of my new pastels.
I could hear it from where I'm sitting. All right, Joan asks, is there a way to erase or lift color from a mistake, or do you just have to cover over with something more opaque? Yeah, you can erase away what you've done, and you're probably going to still see the color there. It's going to leave some residue, some stain, I guess, in the page or in the paper or the whatever your surface is. But then you'll more easily cover the stained area as opposed to maybe having layers of pastel that could get kind of lifted up and mixed in with what whatever color you're using to change the original from.
Yeah, you can kind of use a kneaded eraser to lift up some of the color.
Yeah.
If you want, with soft pastels anyway. Let's see here. I haven't even looked at the time. 14 minutes?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
All right.
I think you're doing good.
The background shouldn't take very long. Let's go ahead and move on to the next candy corn here. Let's go back in with the red.
Yeah, the one in the foreground, you got some nice contrast in that one now.
Yeah, there's little subtle changes in the form in each one of these, and I want to make sure I capture that. So that's what I'm using these reds and grays for.
Especially the one you're working on now. We can see a little more of its surface. It's almost like it's the one that's in most focus.
I won't be using any more new pastels that I don't already have out, that's for sure. Because they are all over the floor. I mean, they are everywhere in little tiny pieces. Oh, my gosh. Hmm. I know what I'll be doing in between shows here.
That's right. Clean up on aisle behind Matt's drawing table.
I don't think I'll be able to clean them up even between the broadcast.
Okay, there is a question about storage. What's the best way to store pastels? I don't really have an answer any more than I think anybody else does. But I would say
we get this question every week.
Yeah, I would say don't put them in a really humid area where they can collect any or very much moisture. Keep them in their case.
Yeah,
ideally.
Everybody knows where I keep mine.
On the floor.
No. They're talking about the pastels themselves or pastel drawings?
I think it's probably, I'm not sure if it's the pastel drawings or not, because we do talk about that pretty frequently. And there was a question earlier in lowercase that I didn't read, but we will talk about, and that is whether to use fixative or not to use fixative, because that's a question that is pretty common and needs an answer. So I'm not sure if the question is about the sticks themselves or the drawings.
All right, now with the orange lighter pencil here, I'm just going to pull out a few of these highlights. I kind of want my candy corn to be a little bit lighter than what they are in the reference. I feel like they're kind of dark in the reference, and I know why they're dark because I edited the photo and brought up some of the contrast, and I feel like they're just too dark for the drawing. If I drew them as dark as they are, mm-hmm. I feel like they wouldn't make a whole lot of sense. We'd lose some of this stuff, some of the little undulations and changes in form.
There's been some conversation in the chat about using cosmetic products to draw and paint with, like using like eyeshadow, kind of like pan pastel or lipstick, like oil pastel. This sounds like a lot of fun. Now, those products are only supposed to, stay on your face for a day. So I can't speak to its light fastness or any of that kind of business that occasionally comes up, because I don't think, they're not really supposed to be permanent. But this sounds like a lot of fun. And incidentally, I've used my wife's makeup brushes plenty of times to sort of dust out the brush strokes of an oil painting. After that, I do not return them, to her makeup set. They are, after that, an oil painting brush for the life of the brush.
Does she ever wonder why you keep stealing her makeup products?
No, I tell her what I'm doing with it. It's okay. Because of my mop brushes, I let paint dry in it or something like that. I like mop brushes made of goat hair for my oil paintings. And sometimes I need a really big one and I don't have it, or I let a little paint dry on the tip and I don't want to, I can't wait for another one to be delivered. So I'll borrow a makeup brush.
So I bet when some of you saw the subject, you're like, how are we going to spend 45 minutes on candy corn?
They're just triangles, Matt.
But as you can see, there's a lot of stuff going on, even in these simple subjects. So don't overlook simple subjects like this.
Yeah, and it's worth noting that, you know, you've got yellow and orange in here, but you're not just using yellow and orange. There's other colors have to get involved and play their part as well.
I found a good color for this.
Okay, so as far as storage goes, getting back to that, it was about both the sticks and the drawings. Yeah.
Okay. I think you just need to store your pastels in a cool, dry place, mm-hmm. as was discussed. But your drawings, I like to store mine in a tabouret. And I have cover sheets in there, but yeah. I don't spray fix anything.
So Matt doesn't use fixative. He's just careful, puts them in drawers, and doesn't slide them around all over each other and carry them around all the time. And uses a cover sheet.
It doesn't mean that you don't, you can't use fixative.
I use fixative. So, I use light application of fixative. Not so much that it'll keep the pastel from smearing. Only that it would discourage the pastel from smearing. Because if you use enough of it, so the pastel will never smear, you're going to definitely change the look of your pastels. They're going to look a lot darker, and you may even end up with some weird, sort of a sandy-feeling texture and even shiny spots. So just be careful with overusing the fixative. You know, they're delicate objects that we're creating, and we need to just treat them like that, and they'll be fine.
Okay, let's pull out some highlights here with a bit of white.
All right.
And we're going to let that go all the way into the body of the candy corn here. Then we'll address our last guy, last candy corn, and then we'll add the background.
Oh, it looks like I've been identified as having misspoken about the makeup brushes that I take from my wife. I guess I should say take, because it was mentioned that I'm not borrowing them if I don't return them. And do I buy her a new one? No, but my wife and I actually are really old school. We don't have her money and my money, so she just buys whatever she wants, and I'm fine with that.
Is that old school?
I think that's old school.
Yeah.
As opposed to separate bank accounts and such. Because then we would have to borrow money from each other, and that would seem weird to me. So she just gets them. Of course, my wife is she's a hairstylist, so she's kind of in that industry anyway. So I wouldn't want to buy her or replace her brushes, because she knows much better than I what's good and what's not. I trust her judgment.
All right, I can't wait to see the blue background and the shadows on these guys. But we got
6 minutes. It's almost time.
Well, we know that that's a suggestion. I really thought there was no way that I wasn't going to get these candy corns done.
You know, you can every drawing goes to the 45 minutes. There is no. You can always spend more time on it. You can stop earlier, but 45 minutes is pretty minimal, no matter what your subject matter is. All right, so Shelley asks. Ashley, what kind of fixative do you use? Are there bad fixatives? I use Grumbacher fixative because I'm one of those people who are loyal to a brand that I've used my whole life. You know, it's sort of that like that the phrase about the devil you know. I feel comfortable with Grumbacher because it's always worked for me. I don't think fixative is crazy complicated to produce, so I don't know that there are bad fixatives. But I would say that fixative can kind of go bad. You know, the nozzle, you know, cheap nozzles with any kind of a spray can will kind of sputter. So if your fixative starts to get a little old, some of it could dry in the nozzle, and you could get splatter. And that's when fixative is bad. Even Grumbacher fixative, which I think is great, that can happen too. So be careful with that. Always test your fixative before you spray it at your artwork and make sure little droplets aren't coming out and it's really coming out in a super fine mist.
All right. I know this is a different pencil, but This is one we haven't seen yet, but this pencil is doing a pretty good job of mixing the pencil applications with the pastel applications. So I didn't want to use another dark gray there. I wanted that shadow to maybe not end so abruptly right there, though. Since we've got most of this candy corn in shadow.
Eli says the timer and taking your wife's makeup is only a suggestion. That's right. It's only a suggestion. You don't have to do. You can follow the timer and you don't have to take your wife's stuff.
Yeah. You don't have to take your wife's stuff. All right. I'm feeling the heat now. 4 minutes. So I'm obviously not going to get the background and shadows done in the time period, but I think I'll be able to get the candy corn's done.
Yeah.
Well, done is a relative term, of course.
As long as they're evenly developed, you can always say it's done. Orion Nebula asks, what pencils are you using again?
These are Carbothello pencils by Stabilo.
Carbothello by Stabilo. Very good.
Yep. And they're harder. They're definitely harder pastel pencils. But some people are going to like harder pastel pencils.
Buddy mentions that I said mist, and it has an entirely different meaning in German. That's true. I wasn't cursing at anybody, I promise. I'm not. It's not a comment on Matt's artwork.
A little bit of white at the top here. And then we'll do our background and our shadows.
So these are more dusty. You've mentioned that. And there's been some comments that you've been having to blow on your pastel away a little bit.
Yeah.
And the pencils are just a little more dustier. And, you know, Matt works on a pretty flat surface just because of the filming. So.
Well, it's not the pencil that's dusty. I know it seems like it's the pencil, but what's happening is the pencil's moving the pastel around that's sitting on the surface. And that's what's making it look like it's dusty. But it's not. It's actually the pastel dust. All right, the pastel dust from the pastel. Let's start here. And first, we're going to add some cast shadows underneath these guys. And then we'll go over the top of it with our blue background. So I'm going to start with kind of a medium to dark gray here. And drop that cast shadow in here.
So I think you got time. You still got a minute and 50 seconds.
Doing things a little bit backwards, where you would think we would just do the background first and then add the shadows, but I don't want to lose these shadows. So we'll go ahead and just fill in the shapes for them, and then we'll add the blue, and any mixing that we need to do, we'll do that. And then we'll need to make that edge a little bit more contrasty underneath these guys, too. Look at that. That's called dirty fingers.
All right. Speaking of dirty fingers.
We'll start right there. See, that's wonderful about soft pastels. Look at that. Just right over the top. Now, this is a very light blue, and this light blue hopefully is going to contrast against the oranges that we have in place, and it'll make for a nice little interesting composition here.
Oh, it's definitely going to contrast, and that's because you've selected a complementary color relationship, so we can't get away from that contrast. That's great,
this one's kind of, because of the way I've done it, it's kind of pushing a split complementary color scheme.
Because you do have a good bit of red in your orange, don't you?
Yeah, there's a yellow orange, a red orange, and a blue.
You're right. So
we're getting close to that anyway.
Donna Good says, this is so Andy Warhol. Now I can kind of see that. Yeah, I mean, kind of candy corn or something that's very much part of pop culture. So I could say, I agree. And there's repetition here. So the bright colors, it's a lot of a lot of Andy Warhol going on in here. Some similarities. It's not a print, but you almost can't tell Andy Warhol's artwork's print anyway. Linda Clark says, this is where you could use pan pastels.
This is where you would use pan pastels, but it would still, you would still have to dip the applicator in the pan pastel and then move it around. And for me, anyway, every time I've used the pan pastels, you really have to spend some time getting the material on the applicator in order to have enough of it to put down on the surface. And I use pan pastels from time to time.
Yeah, you do.
It sounds like I just kind of insinuate negativity with pan pastels. But
you've got some pieces that you've done with pastels here.
Well, the colored pencil bird, I used that for the background.
You use pan pastels in the very first season of Getting Sketchy, too, with a boat.
Oh, yeah, I did.
A boat drawing.
Yeah, that's really old. With colored pencils.
Mm-hmm. Julie says, Matt, you still have 5 minutes.
No, I don't.
Time's up. But
she's
still 5 minutes left in the show.
She's living 5 minutes in the past.
Oh, that's right.
That
we're
an old one.
We're a little bit ahead of you guys.
Yeah.
It's so, in case I use curse words, Matt can edit me out.
I don't know if I could stop that or not, actually.
It's not really for that reason. It's for wardrobe malfunctions, just in case. We don't want to expose you guys to any wardrobe malfunctions.
All right. Well, filling this in is not going to be enough. We're going to need to make the shadow underneath. Need to just make these pop a little bit more.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I know this is a sketch, and I know it's quick, but it does give you a little bit of an idea of how simple subjects can really make some really nice paintings.
Yeah, sometimes they have an immediate visual impact, which is nice about them. They really, really grab your attention.
You can imagine if this was a large painting.
Well, that'd be wonderful.
Yeah, it'd be really cool, I think.
Eli says, the background really makes everything pop. Really amazing drawing, Matt. Yeah, it makes a big difference. Once, I mean, it's so light blue and so pale, but it makes such a difference against these warm colors.
Yeah, just a little bit of color. All right, let's make these candy corn stand out now. So I'm going to go in with this dark gray here, and we're not going to necessarily outline. We're just going to make this shadow real close to the edge a little bit stronger.
Yeah, I mean, this is definitely apparent in the reference. So these dark accents.
And that might be too strong. So I think this is the color I used for the shadow. Yeah.
Just gonna go back into that darker line just a little bit.
Yeah, just back it off a little bit so it doesn't look.
So Matt's using the pastel like its own eraser, you know.
Yeah.
Marie says it looks like we could pick it off the page now.
Well, yeah, I want it to look that way, but I also don't want the lines that I add here to translate as outlines. They need to just be kind of nice and soft. Ooh, look at that. Right underneath this guy. This guy has a strong shadow.
Mm-hmm. Brent Does Art says, next week, Ashley will be drawing a Reese's peanut butter cup. No, that's Matt's motif. I'm not going to do food items this time. But I would love to eat a Reese's peanut butter cup. That's one of my favorites. I'm a big, you know, we talked about peanuts. You talked about peanuts and candy corn. So I'm a big fan of peanuts and peanut butter and Reese's cups and all that kind of stuff. So,
okay. Well, since the time's up, I'll consider this one finished. But you can see how the pastels kind of take on a painterly feel.
Oh, yeah.
Now, I clearly exaggerated the little shapes and forms that I was seeing there. I made these candy corn look a lot more muscular.
Yeah, they have that little tiny triangle, you know, that just barely sticks up on the surface. And you accentuated the form of that. It looks good, though. I like it.
But by doing that, yeah, you make things a little bit more interesting, too. And remember, the goal is to create a finished drawing or painting when you're creating a piece of art, not a replica of the photo reference, although we're using the reference as a guide. But the best part is left, and that's taking the tape off. So let me take the tape off.
Oh,
even though this is a sketch here. Now, when you pull tape away from Look at that. Some of the pastel snuck underneath.
It did.
When you pull tape away from a drawing like this, you want to pull it at a 90-degree angle. You see that? So I'm actually pulling it out sideways as I'm pulling it away, and that will help keep the tape from tearing your paper. Now, a tough paper like this pastel matte paper, probably not going to tear the paper. This paper is pretty tough. And this paper can handle lots and lots of layered applications here. So,
but if you were using something like thin charcoal paper, you have to be really careful with that.
Yeah, you do have to be really careful.
This is where you want to, like Matt said, pull low and away, low and away.
All right, there we go. Not a whole lot of contrast here between the background and the color, but at least enough. All right, do we have any other questions about this?
Let's see.
Does anybody want to come pick clean what up a all difference, these
yeah,
new
what
pastels?
A difference the background makes. Great work, Matt. There's sort of a pink cast in the shadow of the foremost candy corn, or is it? It could be just the colors kind of causing us to see a tone in the neutral color.
Yeah, there could be a little bit of reflected color coming up from that. But let me tell you guys. I edit these photos, and what I did is I took the candy corn and I intensified the contrast and the color intensity. Mm-hmm. Then on a separate layer, I isolated the candy corn, and then on the background, I added a blue tint, a light blue tint to the background. By doing so, it's too contrasty is what I'm trying to say. The photo reference is the candy corn ended up being too dark. And the background in the photo reference wasn't blue enough. So I just made those adjustments in the drawing. But one thing I want to point out about the composition, is I feel like the composition in the photo reference, one of the reasons why I was drawn to it, of course, I arranged these candy corns, but I wanted to create kind of a diagonal that was happening there. Mm-hmm. But there was a little bit of a continuity happening here where there's a diagonal here, another diagonal here, and that brings the candy corn up. And this space right here is actually aided by that cast shadow in the reference that we left out because this is there's two light sources and I wanted to keep it simple. I really think that if I was to do this over or if I was going to rethink this, I would include all of the shadows and include, instead of simplifying it down just because this is a sketch, because I think that shadow right there is somewhat essential to the success of the composition. There feels like there's a lot of, maybe too much negative space at this point.
Yeah, even the shadow is not an actual thing. It does sort of take up space.
It's not a thing, but it's a shape.
Yeah.
It's a visual shape that happens within the picture plane.
Yeah, that's true.
Shadows are important too. And in this case, I feel like this drawing would be, it would benefit the drawing to have the shadow. Okay,
great comment. Let's see. Shelley says they're much more Halloweenish than the original candy corn. And Monica adds, sure appreciate all the extra information you provide about your process. Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. And I hope these are more Halloween than the original candy corn. I hope that doesn't
mean they're
scary.
Spooky. They're spooky.
All right. If that's it, I'm already starting to clean what we're doing with the law of lessons.
That's
so
right.
Let me go ahead and switch out over here. Well, thank you guys for joining us tonight on Getting Sketchy. I hope you enjoyed it. I definitely enjoyed it. Every time we do one of these episodes, you never know what's going to happen live. And I really thought that I would have no problem with the candy corns inside of the time frame. But like we mentioned earlier, your process expands to the amount of time that you provide for it. And 45 minutes, of course, is not a whole lot of time. It may seem like a lot of time to you guys, but if you spend 45 minutes every day on your drawing, then you're going to see improvement. Whether you're working on a more finished, more polished drawing, or if you're working on little sketches like we did tonight, the more you practice, the better you're going to get. Drawing is a skill. Painting is a skill that anyone can learn and develop. And if you want to really hone your drawing and painting skills, again, there's a link in the description below to check out the membership program and also to get on our email list. So don't forget to do that. If you're new to the channel, subscribe to the channel and also like this video. I always forget to say that, like the video. Apparently it's very important for me to say like the video. So please like the video, that will help us out a lot. Ashley, got anything to add or take away?
I don't think so. I enjoyed watching you draw the candy corn. I love candy. I just don't eat it much anymore. So I'm living vicariously through Matt's drawings. Next week, I'll be drawing, and I'm not exactly sure what I'll be drawing or the media, but I do have sort of a pathway motif happening. If it becomes difficult to select or find pathways I want to use, I'll just throw the motif out the window, and we'll think of something else that's fun to draw. So I'd say that time is our most valuable commodity, so thank you for spending your time with us, and we'd like to spend a little more time with you here next week, 6:30 Eastern Standard Time.
And if you want to spend more time with us now, we're going to be live in just about 25 minutes from now, which reminds me, speaking of time, we are out of time. So I hope you guys have a wonderful week. Thanks for joining us. I hope you enjoyed it. I definitely did. Good night, everybody.